In the mid-1980s, the decision was made to move Disney Animation off the lot in Burbank to a warehouse in Glendale on Flower Street. My name is Ron Clements. I was the co-writer and co-director of The Little Mermaid. This was the place?
This was the place where magic was made. This parking lot used to hold much more than just this.
My name is John Musker. I'm one of the writer-directors, and in fact, the only writer-director-producer on The Little Mermaid.
Right about the time we got Little Mermaid going, that was the time when we left the main studio lot in Burbank.
The old animation building on the lot is where the classic films were done, Cinderella and Peter Pan, Lady and the Tramp. Great building, designed specifically for animation. We were banished from that building, unfortunately, in 1985.
When we left the animation building in Burbank, these trailers were put over here.
We literally, mobile homes were sort of wedged together with a few steps up into them.
The 1980s were a time of transition at the Disney studio. A lot of the veteran animators and artists who had built the company and built the studio's reputation were retiring. Some passed away.
The evolution of the art was all concentrated in those guys.
If you look at Jungle Book, Peter Pan, all those classics with Walt, it's a very inspiring thing. And it can be a depressing thing at the same time. It inspires you because you can see how good animation can be. But then you come down and you think, well, will I ever be this good?
The company was not doing very well and not living up to all the promises that, are inherent in the name Disney.
We were in a dark spell. I mean, nothing seemed to go right. Walt had died.
Disney Animation was at risk. There was some talk or some thought of shutting down that department. Unthinkable, and yet it was something that was being considered.
They just didn't realize that animation was the cornerstone of the company, and they didn't realize how much profit it could generate.
When we moved to the Flower Street building, it was like the earth was just turned up. Everything under the surface suddenly came up on top.
I thought, well, this might be the beginning of the end. I mean, lots of us thought that way.
It felt like, okay, the writing is on the wall. We've got to prove ourselves.
As a kid, I grew up with these movies like everyone else, loved them. But I didn't know anything more about them than as an audience. Hi, I'm Jeffrey Katzenberg. During the time of Little Mermaid, I was chairman of the Walt Disney Studios.
I had no animation experience or animation knowledge when I came. Hi, I'm Peter Schneider. I was the vice president of feature animation when Little Mermaid was made. But I recognized that there was something extremely powerful about what could happen at feature animation.
We're here today to meet the chairman and chief executive officer, president, chief operating officer of our company. It's the beginning of a new era.
The situation that led up to the management change in 1984 was when we just tried to bring in people who knew how to run a film company. And we felt we had that between Michael Eisner on the creative side and Frank Wells on the business side.
The selection of Frank and myself to work with you in this company, we think, is an indication that the board of directors have decided that this company will be led from a creative point of view.
Michael was the glue that held it all together, in my opinion. His wacky, nutty, fantastic artistic ideas drove the company. You went to Frank to try and solve problems. He was impatient with you, but he was sort of the peacemaker.
We are here to operate this company the way Walt Disney laid it down decades ago.
The new regime, headed by Michael Eisner and Frank Wells, came to the Disney studio with a clean slate. They had no history with animation, and they had, I think, no axe to grind and no prejudices.
Michael brought Jeffrey Katzenberg in, who he had worked with closely at Paramount.
My instinct and inclination each step along the way was to bring the knowledges and the experiences I had from the live action business and the resources from that into the animated film. You know, many times that was a good thing, many times it was not such a good thing.
Jeffrey took on the project of revitalizing the studio, and Roy Disney took on the project of how do I make animation work.
I remember the first screening he came to, and it was, my God, he looks and sounds like Walt.
I think as much as anything, I was a moral support to everybody because they, most of them knew me anyway, and they knew I was on their side. So Michael Eisner came to me and said, what do you think about moving off the lot? I think there were only 125 people in the whole animation department. And we had this nice big building designed for them, but of course needed for other things.
It was the prime real estate to attract big filmmakers. You wanted them on the lot and therefore throw them off the lot. It's the best thing that ever happened to the animators, as it turns out.
Peter Schneider was also a major influence in the studio at that time because he fostered this whole idea of communication.
It was a collective process. There's no one person can take ownership. That's what's so beautiful about animation. It's everybody.
During this time, I don't think there was any sense that animation was a big business or that it could be a big business.
A former CEO had made a statement at one point, we may bore you, but we will never shock you. And somehow it didn't feel like something, yes, yeah. Yes,
we can bore people.
There's a very entrenched group of people there and ways of doing things. It had to be shook up a bit, and it was tough and not popular.
When I first worked at the conference room in feature animation, there was two pictures on the wall, Walt and Brother Roy, staring over our shoulders. And everything anybody talked about was, what would have Walt done? What would have Walt done?
I kept hearing this refrain over and over and over. I said, you know, we're not Walt. We have to be us. And we have to find our own way.
And I think what happened at the time when Jeffrey, Michael, Roy, and Frank got there was they put tremendous pressure on the company to start performing.
Jeffrey was really a pusher. You know, he was not good enough, not good enough, not good enough.
In the first couple of weeks I was at the studio, I saw The Black Cauldron.
The Black Cauldron was a very expensive movie that took a long time to make, took about 4 years in production.
I saw that film and I just said, well, this is just way, way, way too violent and too scary. And, you know, you have to edit some of these things out. And they said, well, you can't edit an animated movie. And I said, well, of course you can edit an animated movie. They said, well, no, you can't. You cannot, you know, and this was like, okay, this is where one of the first places that the culture clashed like crazy.
One thing you do have to give credit to Michael and Jeffrey for were lighting a fire under the whole process.
My experience was with kindly old men with the cardigan sweaters, and here's these guys hollering in the middle of story meetings.
You had to answer for everything you did. You were expected to deliver quickly. It was like turning on a switch, and there was a lot of juice running through the room.
And it was just a change in energy. I guess there were a whole bunch of forces that collided, and the sparks were good.
Without the personalities of these four men, Eisner, Wells, Katzenberg, and Disney, it wouldn't have happened. Together and collectively, they reinvented a company.
I think John and Ron are really great storytellers. They understood the essence of a great Disney animated movie.
I sensed a marriage that had to be formed between our process and their process. I'm Alan Menken. I'm the composer of the music for Little Mermaid.
The melding of our strengths, I think, gave kind of a stronger thing than either one of us could have done individually. In January of 1985, we had the first of what was called a gong show. This was a concept that Michael Eisner brought over to Disney from Paramount.
It was an opportunity for all of us to get together and to sort of open the doors up and hear everything and anything.
Everyone was supposed to come up with five new ideas for animated features. And I went out and looked for ideas, and I went into a bookstore and I read The Little Mermaid and got very excited about it and wondered why it had never been done before. And then realized when I got to the end that it was a very sad story where the mermaid dies at the end and loses her prince. But I came up with an idea of a way to make it end in a happier way, wrote up a two-page treatment, And then when we reconvened 2 weeks later, I pitched The Little Mermaid. It actually got gonged.
It was gonged because they were in development at that point on a sequel to Splash, and they thought it would be too close, so they just said, nah, we're doing the sequel to Splash, forget it.
But the next day, I got a call from Jeffrey Katzenberg, who said he had read the treatment and actually thought it had potential, and it was put in development.
It was outstanding, and it was better in the writing than it was in the telling. The question was, what do you do with it next? In the world in which I come from, go hire a great screenwriter.
So I guess he was checking out other writers, people were sending in drafts and everything, and Ron Clements finally came to him and said, I think we can do a good job on this.
John Musker and I, we had worked together quite a bit. We were both writers as well as story men, so it seemed natural to ask him if he would want to collaborate on a script.
Ron and John really fought passionately for an opportunity to write it. And, you know, as animators and as animation directors, it never occurred to me that they were screenwriters.
The idea of doing a fairy tale appealed to me because it was certainly part of the Disney tradition, but there hadn't been one in 30 years. So it was doing something in a tradition and yet trying to find a new approach to it that really hadn't been done before.
They wrote a stunning screenplay. I mean, just to this day, I remember it as being one of the best of anything I've ever had.
When I think of Ron and John, I think first of their sense of humor. And that's what permeates all of their movies. And it's a good-natured sense of humor.
My sense of humor is a little more low-key, maybe a little more self-deprecating. I'd say John has a more cutting sense of humor. He's edgier.
Ron and John are so quiet, you wouldn't think of them as being, you know, wild cartoon directors.
You think that everything you say is fine with them because they will think about it and be just fine with it. And then they'll go off and do whatever they damn well want.
So while we were working on this script, we heard that Howard Ashman had actually been approached by the studio and was actually interested in working on The Little Mermaid.
David Geffen called me up one day and said, you must meet Howard Ashman.
Howard Ashman had been an off-Broadway director, book writer, and lyricist. So he was a bubbling under, I guess, Broadway talent.
Howard always knew he was going to be in theater, I think from the age of 10 on. After he moved to New York, he had a lot of jobs, did a lot of things. Nobody's an overnight success. He eventually wrote Little Shop of Horrors, and it was a tremendous success.
We were two people from Baltimore that somehow had made a living doing something that was not so easy to do when you start out here, and for celebrating a different kind of taste, or, you know, a different kind of beautiful villain, or a plant that ate you, or all things that seemed very normal in Baltimore.
If you look at Howard Ashman's play, Little Shop of Horrors, it's very animation, very cartoony, very caricature. It's almost like a cartoon in live action.
I first met Howard because, like every other person in the world, I wanted to do a musical. So I called him up, and I thought he was a genius.
Howard gave me the best advice of anybody ever regarding directing this kind of movie. He said, Frank, this is supposed to be stupid. And it was the best advice. He said, my tongue was firmly in my cheek when I wrote this.
After Little Shop, Howard wrote a show called Smile that went on to Broadway, and that starred Jody. And it was not a great success.
Because he wore so many creative hats, he had a lot of people that he had to answer to. And so I think that made it difficult.
His vision on Smile got compromised and compromised and compromised, whereas to the point that when it came out, it wasn't the play he wanted.
When Smile closed, he was looking for really all kinds of projects that had nothing to do with Broadway.
David Geffen had called Jeffrey Katzenberg and basically said, there's this brilliant talent named Howard Ashman, and you have to have him at the Walt Disney Company, so go get him.
Once I realized that Howard was the genie and had the answers, you know, I was unmerciful. I mean, I wasn't going to let that guy get away from us no matter what.
The escape to Burbank, to Hollywood, to film, to the West Coast, and to this form was absolutely essential to his inner being.
I grew up on Pinocchio and Peter Pan, and the idea of doing one of those is like there's all these library books on the shelf. There's Snow White, and there's Sleeping Beauty, and there's Cinderella, there's Peter Pan, there's Pinocchio. And to try to make something that fits comfortably on the shelf with those, I mean, that's like what a difficult thing to do, but what a great thing to try to do.
I think Ron and John were very skeptical. I think they were very, I don't know. And yet when they met Howard, it all melted.
He was really enthusiastic about the project. To him, this was all new, and it was great. It was exciting, and that was exciting to us.
It was with great pleasure when I received a call from Howard about The Little Mermaid. It was an instant yes, primarily because I wanted to work with Howard again.
Al is a genius at coming up with that melody, making that lyric work, putting the lyric together with that melody.
I had never written a score. I had written, you know, the incidental music in my own musicals, and Howard convinced me I should take that on.
And I remember very strongly that he was new. He was writing these songs, and it's not clear he could score the movie, and that's part of the journey. You start with people who are unsure and have great faith in them. You believe in them, and maybe they'll make magic.
So it was this collaboration between them, two talented people but with no experience in film or animation, and the young, gifted people at the Disney studio who were looking for something fresh and exciting to do, that created lightning. Lightning struck.
It is very, very hard to deliver a successful musical. And it takes a lot of serendipity.
Certainly music has always been a big part of the early Disney films, and it's something that the studio had gotten away from.
As they went to work in their little music room at the studio, it was like people listening in on the door.
In December of 1986, we went out to visit Howard in New York. We went to his apartment in Soho. It was a cold December, blustery, freezing day, and we were in this kind of warmly lit apartment. There was a piano there. Alan came over, and he played Part of Your World for us on the piano while Howard sang. And Howard did it as a theater performance. It was like we weren't really there.
Howard brought in a wonderful understanding of story and character and how songs can define story and character.
We got to create the mood. Percussion.
I don't know where the knowledge came from with it. I don't know how it came to be, but man, he just understood it.
There you see her, sitting there across the way.
We were adapting Hans Christian Andersen's fairy tale in the style of Disney. And so in a sense, we were pastiching Disney. In order to pastiche Disney, we naturally brought in styles from the outside. And calypso and reggae were clearly a new style to bring in.
Seaweed is always greener in somebody else's lake. You dream about the going up there, but that is a big mistake.
I think that was one of Howard's greatest gifts, was making stylistic marriages.
Don't say a word, and she won't say a word until you kiss the girl.
Howard and Alan actually moved to Los Angeles, and they had offices right there in the animation building.
They would be off in a room, sitting at the piano, making up songs.
This music is Alan Menken composing for The Little Mermaid, but we shouldn't.
So when they're working on Under the Sea, you hear dun da dun dun da dun 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 dun.
I just remember thinking, where does this great music come from? These great songs? We haven't had stuff like this in ages.
Well, the first time I heard Under the Sea, I had that in my car, just wearing it out.
Under the sea, under the sea, nobody beat us, fry us, and eat us in fricassee.
He loved playing with words, obviously. It's obvious from his lyrics.
The flute played the flute, the cop played the harp.
The place played the bass, and he sounded sharp.
The bass played the brass, the chum played the tub.
The trout is rocking out.
The flute is the duke of soul.
Yeah.
The way he can play the lings on the string.
The trout rocking out, the blackfish, he sings. The smelt and the sprat, they know where it's at. And oh, that blowfish blow!
There's something about Under the Sea that, just to me, that's such a Howard song.
What do they got? A lot of sand. We got a hot Christian band.
Every time I heard these songs, they just sort of so effortlessly rolled off, you know, your tongue.
I could think, these are great songs. I have to go work on that movie.
There was electricity in the air. I mean, there was real genius at work and people knew it.
One of the great things with Howard and Allen's music, I think, is the wittiness of it. It isn't dumbed down for any audience.
Sacrebleu! What is this? How on earth could I miss such a sweet little succulent crab?
I think we wanted to make songs that would tell the story, songs that would really move the story forward, really push the plot along and keep things driving ahead.
They approached it like a Broadway musical. It is something totally different. The characters actually run out of words, can't express themselves anymore, and it has to come out in song.
You get to a certain point where the crab has to convince the mermaid not to go up above the water and change her life, so he has to sing Under the Sea. And she has to sing Part of Your World because she wants to go up to dry land so badly.
When she's saying to Flounder, you know, I've got all these treasures around, I've got this and I've got this, and I say, look at this stuff. I mean, it just comes right out of the dialogue that she has. And then she just begins this monologue that happens to be put to music.
I want to be where the people are. I want to see. Wanna see 'em dancing, walking around on those, what do you call them? Oh, feet.
Probably one of the fondest memories I have of working on The Little Mermaid is Howard Ashman right next to me.
I'm gonna try one more, even more, using more of the tomboyish.
He would literally just play all the characters.
I know I heard Howard play Ariel so many times on demo tapes and just sitting around.
Our demos, which we would do together, were the blueprints for every song, and everybody would know exactly what we wanted these songs to be.
The homework was already done. I just took it and I just stole everything that he did.
What would I give if I could live out of these waters? The intensity is better than... What would I give is better than noise.
He would raise me up to such a level of a performance.
What would I give if I could live out of these waters? What would I pay to spend a day warm on the sand?
And I got the video of the recording and watched Jody sing, and it was, oh, just seeing it in her eyes, she believed it just like I believed it in listening to it.
I think what Glenn could pick up as he listened to it was the sheer heart of Ariel.
There was this connection. It's like, I've got to make that character as real as it is in my head.
When's it my turn? Would my love to explore that shore up above? Out of the sea. Oh, wish I could be part of that world.
Howard worked that way with everyone. I mean, if he had the opportunity, he could make a connection with actors and sort of get into their psyche and share it with them, and they kind of cohabit the character.
Come in. Come in, my child. We mustn't lurk in doorways. It's rude.
One might question your upbringing. There's a little bit of business which we wrote down here which we should include up here, which is...
I had wanted all my life to work in a Disney film.
So we wanted to put a chuckle over, sort of one of your low chuckles, over that move to the vanity.
And when I was called by the agent to say, would you like to audition for a Disney film, I said, oh my lord, that's an answer to prayer. Of course I would. We mustn't lurk in doorways. It's rude. One might question your upbringing. One day, we were waiting in a music rehearsal for something. I said, Howard, may I ask you a favor? And he said, sure. I said, could you sing Ursula's song for me? Well, he put on the cloak immediately, sang the song. He was brilliant.
Yes, I've had the odd complaint, but on the whole, I've been a saint to those poor, unfortunate souls.
And And I watched every body move of his. I watched everything. I watched his face. I watched his hands. I ate him up.
Have we got a deal?
I stole Innit from Howard.
Life's full of tough choices, Innit.
I stole two or three other ad-libs that he put in.
No more talking, singing, zip.
And I said, Howard, is it all right if I steal those? He said, I was hoping you would.
Come on, you poor unfortunate soul! Go ahead, make your choice!
The Witch's Song, it had that kind of sexy, sleazy kind of sound to it. Immediately starts making you think of how you're going to draw this character.
Sad, but true! If you want to cross a bridge, my sweet, you've got to pay the toll. Take a gulp and take a breath and go ahead and sign the scroll.
But I think Howard loved the character of Ursula. I think he really loved her because she was theatrical.
This poor, unfortunate soul!
Might have been surprising to me at the time that Howard could end up after making Little Shop of Horrors, but it was a great play, though. In the Disney camp, yes, I'm sure it surprised him. But then the same way people say to me today, your play won the Tony? Families are going to see Hairspray?
The truth is that those two entities found one another and something incredible happened to Howard, Allen, and Disney. The sum of the parts was greater than anything you could have imagined.
The process of making these animated movies is a marathon, not a sprint.
One might think it was all easy swimming and long strokes, but in reality, I feel like a lot of the movie, we were underwater.
Worrying about the film, is the film going to work? And of course, will the film get done in time? And what if it doesn't?
When we all got booted out of the old animation building and moved into these warehouses on Flower Street, it was the best thing that possibly could have happened for us.
The work did get better. And there was a kind of a morale improvement in throughout the whole group.
Jeffrey would see some dailies or see a sequence and he would call you up and say, hey, the character's really coming through. It was very meaningful to us.
Me and John and Ron and Glenn Keane and Roger Allers and these people, there was a real belief that they could do better than Walt Disney. It was not an ego thing, but I think artists have to have the ability to say, I can do better.
The choices that you make in doing an animated picture aren't necessarily about trying to do something new. It wasn't so much a, okay, we're going to do a new heroine.
I approached her with the idea that she was a real teenager with genuine teenage angst about, you know, I'm still a little girl, but I want to be a big girl.
I'm 16 years old. I'm not a child.
Don't
anymore.
You take that tone of voice with me, young lady.
The choice for red hair was definitely a very conscious, deliberate choice. For me, what I remember was simply the fact that we had just come out with a mermaid picture in Splash, and you had a blonde Daryl Hannah. So right away, it was just like, well, we got to do something different.
I remember a major argument over Ariel's hair. People would walk into the room with totally different images in their heads. Jeffrey thought he was going to see Daryl Hannah, maybe.
You know, he's like, guys, everybody knows mermaids are blonde, okay? And we're like, do they know that? Do we know that?
The choice of a red hair for Ariel works way better than blonde because, for one thing, you've got these lovely compliments. You've got the red on top and the green tail. So you've got two compliments, which gives you an energy.
I knew it!
Also, you want to take her into a dark place and her hair gets darker. A dark shade of red is really much more easy to accomplish than to take yellow and make a dark yellow.
Blech. All characters go through this where you start out with something that's close and it kind of evolves. But I think Ursula probably, more than any character, went through a huge amount of reiterations before ending up with the final design.
In the original development drawings, she was played as a lionfish or a scorpionfish, where she had all these spikes and spines. Then it was Matt O'Callaghan, who was storyboarding on the movie. He really came up with the idea of the witch as an octopus, and that really launched it in a different direction that we thought actually made sense.
We tried fat versions, we tried skinny versions, and the fat ones always look more interesting.
Divine was an influence. Divine was this person that Howard knew from Baltimore, who's a cross-dressing guy who was in these John Waters movies.
I thought it was great. It was the ultimate irony. I'm sure that if you went to the Disney executives before they made this movie and said, we're going to have a very large character, and this character is a big character in the movie. It's not some tiny little ingenue part that comes in for a second. And we're going to base it on Divine, and you know who that is. On Dopey Lane, that ain't flying, I'll tell you.
And many people call her an octopus, and I'm so knowledgeable, I have to correct them and say, no, she is not an octopus, she is a squid. And they go, oh, well, what does that mean? She has 6 tentacles instead of 8, which makes it less expensive to draw.
I admit that in the past I've been a nasty. They weren't kidding when they called me, well, a witch. But you'll find that nowadays I've mended all my ways, repented, seen the light, and made a switch. True, yes.
The way we were dealing with the actress at that point a lot of times is John would be in the booth and I would be out at the microphone with the actor.
And he's real frustrated because, you know, nothing seems to be happening there.
Some enjoyed that, but Buddy Hackett, I think, didn't necessarily. He was uncomfortable that first day for whatever reason, and I was making him more nervous.
One day left and that boy ain't puckered up once.
What did he say?
He said, okay, I'd like to do it again. Alone.
He looked over his shoulder.
Only one day left and that boy ain't puckered up once. Maybe his lips is bent.
So he got comfortable and then everything was fine after that.
Yeah,
but,
it was just a moment.
But he was a character. Buddy was a character.
Only one day left and that boy ain't pucked it up once.
Sam Wright was a great inspiration in the character Sebastian.
I love his bottom lip.
He was a Broadway performer. He could dance and he would move in front of the microphone and he'd be really deeply into character.
Yes!
Thank you. Thank you.
You want to hear? You can hear what you heard the first time.
Yes. Yes, Your Majesty.
Yes, so we're thinking to just to push the extreme just a little bit further, even higher on that, you know.
Yes!
Yeah.
Yes, Your Majesty.
Yes!
Yes, Your Majesty.
After having written the script, we went into storyboards. We put the film on reels, which is shooting the storyboard drawings and filming them.
There was no animation, but we had the dialogue, we had the voices, we had story sketches to illustrate all the story points.
It was right around the end of 1987, early 1988, that we showed this assemblage of the whole movie to Jeffrey Katzenberg. Here's our movie, here are the songs plugged in, here's the story, here's the characters. What do you think?
And his reaction was, I love the script, I love the songs, I don't love this. Why don't I love this?
You cannot see what you're looking at. You have to see what it's going to become.
You know, Ron and John had a lot more experience with it than anybody else did. And they could look at a pencil test and know that that pratfall would work just fine when it was in color. But Jeffrey had no experience with that.
He had no patience. I mean, they were so used to everything going fast, 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 and animation is just like snails.
If you asked 100 people that know me to list all the, you know, those things about me, not one of them would have the word patience, ever.
I saw him beating his head on the door one time. He's so frustrated.
And here's the irony. The thing I end up finding myself doing, devoted to, in love with, is making something that takes infinite patience.
Certainly the stress level, I think, kind of took off at that point because suddenly this charm project that could do no wrong was possibly in trouble.
When we ran into some story trouble partway through the movie, where certain story points weren't firing off, Howard actually stepped in and rewrote some of those specific scenes.
We knew that Howard was a director and Howard was a writer and he was really good in all those areas.
I never knew Howard to just do one thing on any production. He had to get more involved.
he did three key scenes that really had a huge effect on the movie. I think they're three of the nicest scenes in the movie, and they were all written by Howard.
The first one was when she was on the beach and the crab was in her hands.
You could go home with all the normal fish and just be miserable for the rest of your life.
And that's the point where we actually see the change in Sebastian. He's changed from like, okay, I thought this was a mistake, but from this point, I'm on your side.
All right, all right. I'll try to help you find that prince.
Then Howard wrote the nighttime scene where he was really trying to coach her.
You gotta botch your eyes like this. You gotta puckle up your lips like this.
And then, the most crucial of all, perhaps, he rewrote our last scene with the king watching Ariel where he decides to give her legs.
Originally, that scene didn't have dialogue. It was all done visually. I guess we thought, well, you know, we can just put it over with the looks and the expressions. But Howard felt that we shouldn't be afraid of really having the words spoken.
Then I guess there's just one problem left.
And what's that, Your Majesty?
How much I'm going to miss her.
That solidified what the movie, in essence, is all about, which is the king realizing that he can't control his daughter and that she has to follow her heart.
Before we were going to take the movie out to a theater and preview it, we did sort of a step down from that preview where we just invited a bunch of school kids to our building in the theater at Flower Street.
This story is true and deeply humiliating, but we'll tell it.
I storyboarded a part of your world and had probably animated half the song.
I wanna see them dancing.
And so we rolled the movie, and they did squirm during part of your world.
A child dropped their popcorn box, or the container of popcorn, and became restless with needing to clean that up. And Jeffrey took that as a sign.
I came out of that and just said, don't think this is working.
He said, maybe we should lose the song.
Howard's in horror, we're in horror. Glenn Keen, who just rough animated, is in horror.
To me, it was the last thing I thought possible.
I was, what do we do? What do we do? What do we do? You know.
I was, what? So that's it? It's it? Like all that work is gone?
We made all our arguments and we didn't win. Howard made his arguments even and didn't win. And the person who finally actually talked Jeffrey into at least giving it another chance was Glenn Keane.
I called Jeffrey. Jeffrey, just because of some hyperactive kid sitting in front of you, you can't take it. Glenn, look, I understand. You of all people are going to feel this the most. But it's not just because of that little kid there. It's boring. It's like...
So fortunately, Glenn, through his petitioning Jeffrey Katzenberg, got enough of a reprieve from the governor, a stay of execution, such that we could preview it with the song, and we at least got to animate the song.
Up where they walk, up where they run.
I think it was probably out of the movie for about a minute or two, and, you know, back in, and can't imagine the movie without it, can you?
Wish I could be part of that world.
Along with the pressure of trying to make a great movie, which you feel that pressure really strong, there's another huge pressure of time and budget.
Early days, movies could go on and on and on. I mean, The Black Cauldron, I think, was being worked on for, God knows, 10 years, 15, whatever. So we were under the gun.
You got to deliver the product, and you know the pressure was on to do that. And the filmmaking side of it was not always so understanding of these things.
My wife Marilyn wouldn't see me until sometimes 11, 12 o'clock at night, because we were working overtime to try to get the show done and to try to show management that we were worth something.
Now, Jeffrey was yelling at me every other day that we're spending too much money and we were over budget.
Everything that would be looked at like, how much does that cost? How many fish there? Cut out 10 of those fish. I mean, just whatever it did. Just...
I would come home sometimes, and luckily we had a pool. I would just come home and swim 40 laps, and then I could like breathe.
At this point, you kind of lose perspective, and things you were excited about, you almost forget, and you really lose sight. Is this movie really going to work?
And there was always that sort of collective unspoken thing underneath it all, which was that sort of the division was more or less, riding on it.
Our big fear was that people would compare this to, say, the earlier fairy tales like Snow White and Cinderella and say, what happened?
You've made this. You've worked for 4 years on this. You're scared. You're anxious. It's a musical. It's not even a hit musical in terms of people. It's we're all nobodies. And it catches a wave.
We had this first preview at the AMC Burbank of the unfinished movie, and the numbers were through the roof.
La-la-la-la-la-la, don't be scared.
Talk about a sigh of relief. Because the adult numbers were so high, Jeffrey thought, let's try this with an all-adult audience. We've never done that.
And that went really amazingly well, such that I do remember Jeffrey walking out after that screen just like, wow, like this is a whole new world for him. But he was sort of like, how do we market this movie?
The marketing of these films became an enterprise unto itself. And the guy who was just an awesome, awesome leader in that regard, it was Dick Cook. He understood the ability to synergize across the entire Disney company was one of its great untapped resources.
Maureen Donnelly and I visited Jeffrey Katzenberg after one of these little preview screenings that we had.
He was incredibly gracious, saying how happy everybody was with the movie, that it was great, but to not be disappointed.
He said, you know, it's not going to do as well as Oliver did because that's a boys' movie, and it's the same way in live action. Guys' movies do better than women's movies. It's just the way it is. And I had never even thought of it as being a girls' movie. I just think if it's engaging, I would think it could transcend gender lines, and in fact, it did.
And I remember actually getting into a discussion with one of the story men where we talked about, is it possible for a Disney animated movie actually to, say, make $100 million?
Doing a movie that's really there, it's like catching lightning in a bottle. You just don't know, never know.
It opened in November of 89. I forget what the opening weekend was, but it was good.
The usual arc, you open and then, right, everything's downhill from that first weekend. But Mermaid just stayed.
It just kept playing and playing and playing and playing and playing and playing.
Our daughter was 3 years old, three and a half, when The Little Mermaid came out. And I think that was possibly the first film she really responded to. And I said to myself, well, I can't just be my little girl doing that.
I never get tired of singing the song. And the reason why I don't get tired of singing the song is because it is a great story. I sing it to my daughter. She'll ask me to sing it probably every other night. Mommy, sing Mermaid.
Wandering free. Wish I could be part of that world.
When people talk about adults going to these movies, it's good enough to go to even if you don't go with a kid. What they really mean is how funny the movies are.
This was a family movie, but at the same time, having fun with it. So the parents weren't wanting to kill themselves while they had to watch it with their children.
I don't think I was at all surprised that it did as well as it did. You know, I wish it was today and it was coming out now because it'd make $500 million. That's how good it was.
One of my great memories of the movie was the night of the Academy Awards when Little Mermaid won Best Song and Best Score.
Howard was very excited to win the Oscar. He loved it. It was fun. It was fun to be acclaimed.
And Mermaid was the one that just awakened people. They went, oh, wow, it's back. It was like this whispering, it's back.
You hope that what engaged you and moved you and excited you will move other people as well. And when it works at its best, that's what happens.
I remember one particular letter from a New Jersey state trooper who said he saw the movie and he was just in tears and he had a relationship with his daughter that was estranged and he called his daughter and they made up.
Little Mermaid is the foundation on which an entire renaissance was built.
It was about the time of Lion King we started calling it a golden age. And that's a measure of how proud everybody was of their work.
Sometimes if you take out one element in a time frame, everything else collapses too. The Black Cauldron served its purpose,
there was good work done in Oliver and Company and The Great Mouse Detective. But when Little Mermaid came along, it was the right film at the right time, and it really did turn everything around.
I don't know when, I don't know how, but I know something's starting right now. Watch and you'll see.